The Lord is risen. Hallelujah. Good morning. Sorry, but that was necessary. I greet you in the name of our Savior Jesus on this beautiful day that God has given to us. It's not supposed to be 97 today, hopefully. That God has given us that we can be gathered around His Word, eager to receive His Easter blessings. And I do have to say that if your team lost down at Norman last night, at least your team didn't lose on national TV 49-14 like my alma mater did. So at least you guys put up a better game. Anyway, so, and for you know, folks, I'm from the University of Wisconsin. That was my undergrad. So they played Ohio State last night and got killed. So turn your bulletins, please, to the blue pages that you'll find there in the middle. There are a few announcements that we need to go over here this morning. First of all, after this service, we're going to be having our, I don't want to say, it's not quarterly, but our third voters meeting of the three that we have each year, where we will simply hear reports. You will have an opportunity to ratify the ballot the nomination committee has made for you. And we do need to discuss, it's been brought up at council, and you need to vote on whether or not you want to get the parking lot fixed. So that will be the meeting, as I know of it, today. Nathan, you're back there. Anything I'm forgetting that you know of? Okay, so I think we got, that'll be it. Oh, no. Are my glasses on my head? I think they're in my office. Hold on a second. Oh, they're there? Okay. Sorry about that. If my eye doctor ever gets his laser fixed, I won't need these anymore. I'm still waiting. All right, so F3 is going to be happening this Wednesday night. The menu for dinner at 6 is going to be a baked potato bar. So we'll have dinner and confirmation at 6. We'll have Bible classes for all ages at 7. So hope to see you here Wednesday night at 6. LWML Sunday is going to be next Sunday, so just want to give you a heads up of that. That's always a fun service for us to do. Dart Ball is going to be Thursday here at 7 p.m. And I don't know why, but which church is it in Guthrie? Our Savior in Guthrie has waited a little while to tell us about their fish fry, but their fish fry is Saturday. So you got an email about that, so if you didn't look at that email and you want to go, we sent that info to you, and I'm sure we'll send it to you again this week, but up at Our Savior in Guthrie, before the virus, every year they'd have this big fish fry, and the fish is brought in from Alaska, and it's a big deal. So if you like fish and chips, I invite you to check it out. Now, besides that, because now I beat you to that, anything I need to, sir? Okay, now obviously it's not to get another bus, it's to fund the bus they have, right, for gas and insurance and stuff. Okay, wanted to make sure we were clear on that. All right, anything else I'm forgetting, overlooking, or in that case not aware of? Yes, ma'am. You can have these.
So anything, readers, I think sunglasses, if they are glasses, bring them here before Thursday of this week and we will get them sent on down. It's for most ministries. They take the lenses out, readjust them for kids in need, and then they have glasses for your charge. So.
Okay. Anything else I'm overlooking? Okay. So for birthdays this week, Kimberly Connor has her birthday today. So Kimberly, happy birthday if you're watching online. Carol Rice has her birthday on Thursday, Matt Raylos on Friday, Jennifer Kettner and Caden Stewart on Saturday. And happy anniversary to Derek and Jennifer Ayers. If you guys are watching online, happy anniversary today, 18 years. David and Christine Murray on Tuesday, 19 years. And then Jerry and Alice Petzold on Thursday, 55 years. So if you guys are watching online, happy anniversary. All right. So let us proceed then to our first song this morning, which is Shine on Us, and God bless our worship together this morning. I thought that turned out well, too. Okay. The congregation will please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, but with you there is forgiveness.
Therefore you are feared.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserve your punishment now and forever. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for our next song.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me.
Continue with the readings. I don't think the mic is on, Todd.
The Old Testament reading this morning comes from the sixth chapter of Amos, beginning with the first verse. Woe to those who are at ease in Zion, and to those who feel secure in the mountain of Samaria, the notable men of the first of the nations to whom the house of Israel comes. Pass over to Calne and see, and from there go to Hamath the Great, then go down to Gath of the Philistines. Are you better than these kingdoms, or is their territory greater than your territory? O you who put far away the day of disaster and bring near the seat of violence. Woe to those who lie on beds of ivory and stretch themselves out on their couches and eat lambs from the flock and calves from the midst of the stall, who sing idle songs to the sound of the harp and, like David, invent for themselves instruments of music, who drink wine in bowls and anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore they shall now be the first of those who go into exile, and the revelry of those who stretch themselves out shall pass away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. He will command his angels concerning you. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
The epistle lesson comes from the third chapter of the first letter to Timothy, beginning with the first verse. The saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not a drunkard, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well, with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace, into a snare of the devil. Deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with clear conscience, and let them also be tested first. Then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their own households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The congregation will please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with all that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, 'Father, Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us.' And he said, Then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. Abraham said to him, If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We now confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell.
The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated that we may sing our song of the month.
From the grave by name, you called me out of all my shame. I see the old has passed away, the new has come. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I trust in your royalty, your Holy Spirit. Has been redeemed, the new has come. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom, freedom. You have given us freedom, you have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom, you have given us freedom, you have given us freedom. Hallelujah. Freedom, you have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Hallelujah. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us in the light of your goodness, you have given us freedom.
Now
I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness.
I hope that's, yay, I like that song instead of, yay, I'm glad they're done. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The text for your sermon here this morning, the biblical basis for our thoughts together here today, are the words of the gospel reading, which I read to you before, Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 19. We begin today with this question. Has it ever happened to you, have you ever known anyone, seen someone on TV, on the internet, whatever, that you look at them and you think, man, they've got it all. They're set. And then it turned out later that they did not. That they did something happened, and their life fell to pieces. I was thinking about that this week because that's kind of what's going on in the parable here today. And I thought of three examples from my younger days in three different but very important areas of American life. TV, politics, and sports. And when I give these examples, for those of you who are of the younger variety, you may not know who these people were, but trust me, I'm old enough to remember who they were, okay? So first we begin with TV. If you are my age or older, you might remember a guy named McLean Stevenson. He was an actor who was getting a bit part here or there. When I was putting the sermon together, I looked him up and I found out something I didn't know. He used to be a guest host on the Johnny Carson show when Johnny was on the Tonight Show. But as at an older age than most guys get their big break, he was hired to play Lieutenant Colonel Henry Blake in the TV version of MASH back in 1972. And so now he had it made. He's an actor, a regular on a huge hit TV show. But then he decided, you know what? I want to be the star. Because as that show began and evolved, Alan Alda, as Hawkeye, ended up being the star. And so McLean Stevenson decided, I want to be the star, I want more money, I want my own show, and so he left MASH. And so over the next decade or so, he had four sitcoms that were tried on NBC. Three of them didn't make it to 6 months. The fourth one lasted two seasons. So if you remember Hello, Larry, you're a trivia master, if you remember that show. But basically, his career went down the tubes and after he left MASH, and that was that. And I read an interview he did where he admitted, after all this had happened, that, you know what, I should have stuck with MASH. I had a good thing, good writers, a good team to work with. I was better off where I was. My second example for you here comes from politics, and his name is Richard Nixon. If you weren't alive when Nixon was president, you certainly know the name. In 1972, he was running for re-election. He'd been president for 4 years. As the primaries were over and they were heading into the summer and the conventions, the polls said things were looking really good. It looked like he had it made. But some folks in his reelection committee didn't want to take any chances. They couldn't leave well enough alone. And so they put a team together who broke into the Democratic National headquarters in the Watergate building in Washington, D.C. And the rest, as they say, is history. Now, President Nixon knew nothing about this break-in, he knew nothing about that, but he did take part in the cover-up. And so in August 1974, right before Congress could vote on impeaching him, he resigned, and he is the only president of our country to have resigned. He had it all set, was looking good, he had it made, but then he didn't. And in the sports world, I'm going back a few years here, to the 1980s, But maybe you remember the name Len Bias. Len Bias was a basketball player, All-American basketball player from the University of Maryland, All-American for two seasons. When he left school and went into the NBA draft, he was selected second overall by the Boston Celtics. Now think about this. The Celtics in the 80s, this was not a team that normally had a second overall pick, but they had traded with a team and they had that second overall pick. So he's drafted to play on the same team with Larry Bird and Kevin McHale and Robert Parrish and those guys who are battling for championships every year. He had it made. A rookie was going to be making big money playing for this fantastic team. He was going to get a lot of rings, a lot of money. He had it made. But 2 days after the draft, he was at a party. He overdosed on cocaine, and he died. He had it made until he didn't. Now, there are some more recent examples of this phenomenon that I could mention to you today. They would include the actress Jennifer Lawrence, politician Anthony Weiner, and yes, that's his name. And when it comes to sports, you all remember Lance Armstrong, right? Well, as I said, our text is something like this. The rich man thought he had it made, but in the end, he did not. And for us, we know through God's word and through the many blessings that we receive through the work of Jesus Christ that because of what he has done for us, we've got it made. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So in this text, Jesus is teaching his followers while they're on the way to Jerusalem for the last time. The Pharisees are also listening to Jesus and were mad at Jesus because he was criticizing their hypocrisy and their love of money and the fact that they didn't listen to God's word. In fact, they were actually guilty of rewriting God's word and adding to God's word, which I've mentioned to you before. And so that was the sin of the rich man in the parable. He wasn't focused on listening to the word of God. He neglected and ignored God's word. And instead, he focused on his own wealth and pleasure and stuff. So here's what we are told here. In the parables that Jesus is teaching, he says, every day this guy led a life of extreme luxury, something many of us would dream about. The Greek word used here for feasting, it said he feasted luxuriously. The Greek word used here is the word where we get in English the word glutton. Okay? So you need to remember here that in the time of Jesus, most people didn't get enough to eat day after day. They didn't have the grocery stores and the stuff and the plenty that we have. Most people in those days were really skinny. The only people who were overweight were royalty and other rich people. Okay? So, as I mentioned at first service, if you're ever watching a movie about Jesus or you're watching that TV show, The Chosen, that's out there now, and I again tell you I recommend The Chosen if you haven't seen it. If you see extras walking around, people acting, pretending to be villagers or whatever, if you ever see any who are overweight, that is a problem. That is not the way it was in the Bible. Everybody then was skinny except really rich people. So this guy is feasting, and what it means here really is he's being a glutton. And you might recall that was one of the seven deadly sins. And so he's living in a real over-the-top manner. So kind of like when Beyonce dropped $40 million to buy her husband a private jet for his first Father's Day present. $40 million. For my first Father's Day present, Erica got me an Xbox. $40,299. $40 million? Okay, anyway. I liked the present. And I certainly wasn't expecting a Gulfstream for Father's Day, okay? Another example of people in our society that live and overspend on things. Meghan Markle, I read, spent $632,000 on her maternity clothes. I think that's a lot of money for clothes. Paris Hilton, I read a few years ago, paid $325,000 for a custom-built doghouse for her little furry friends. $325,000. That's more than our house cost, okay? And this is just for her dogs. So when you hear see stories of celebrities blowing their dough like this, they've got nothing on the guy in the parable. TMZ and Entertainment Tonight would have loved to have covered the rich man in this parable. They would have loved this guy. And so while this guy was living it up, there was a beggar out by the gate of his house. Now, we do not know the exact nature of his illness. We do know that it was bad enough that he couldn't walk. And so they put him there at the gates of this rich man, because, you know, it was a nice neighborhood, so anyone that might be walking around might have some pocket change to give to him. It's apparent he was also hoping to be able to eat the table scraps, or let's just call it what it is, the garbage that the rich man was generating, because that would be better than anything he could get his hands on. Jesus also says in the story that he was covered in sores, which sounds gross, and he was so weak that he couldn't push the dogs away who were licking his sores. Now, I'm guessing that a lot of you, when you heard me say that, when you read that in the bulletin, you were thinking that some nice little puppy dogs were trying to comfort him, you know, like Rufus, and were licking him to make him feel better. But remember, in Jesus' time, dogs were not domesticated. They weren't pets. They were wild animals. This is like wolves, okay? And so these dogs weren't comforting Lazarus. They were eating. Yeah, I know you're looking at me going, ugh. But that's what they were doing, okay? So now when you think about Lazarus, have you ever known anybody in as bad a way as this guy? So now we see a great reversal in this parable. And God really likes doing reversals. You know, the last will be first and the first will be last. So in the parable, the rich man and Lazarus both pass away, and the rich guy ends up in hell, and Lazarus ends up in heaven. And to everyone that Jesus was saying this story to, they would have gone, what? Because this would have been like a big twist ending here. Because in Jesus' time, the Jewish leadership was teaching to their people that if you were rich, if you were wealthy, that meant God loved you more. That meant that you weren't a sinner. You were a good person, and God was rewarding you. And if you were a poor person, if you didn't have anything, that meant God didn't like you, that you weren't obeying him, that you were being a bad person, and God was punishing you by making sure you had nothing. That's what the people were taught, that rich people were going to heaven, the poor people were not. And now Jesus says the exact opposite. And so everyone listening to Jesus' story would have been shocked to hear Jesus say that the rich guy was in hell. And the Pharisees would have objected to this because these were people with money. And they knew that Jesus was talking to them, about them. So the rich man finds himself in hell. And he finds hell to be, shall we say, unpleasant. And so then in this story, we can see that he could see and talk to but not go to those who were in heaven. And this is just Jesus telling a story. The people in hell can't see the people in heaven and vice versa. They can't talk to each other, and they certainly can't pass back and forth. But in this parable, Jesus portrays it this way, and this rich guy is in so much discomfort that he asks Abraham to send Lazarus to him with just one drop of cool water. Hell is so warm. And note that this rich guy, this isn't repentance here. He's still giving orders, and he sees Abraham and Lazarus' folks who are still there to serve him. And we also note that the rich guy knew Lazarus' name. He knew this guy was out there in the front of his house, out there at the gate, but he never did anything for him. And that detail is to show us how negligent, how cold-hearted, how loveless this rich man was. Well, Abraham tells him, no can do. There's no crossing over between heaven and hell. Abraham tells the guy that he got to live it up while he was here, but since there was no real love in his heart, except for his love of his money, certainly not love for God, or certainly no love for Lazarus, now he was stuck in hell forever. And finally, the rich man thinks of someone other than himself, and he asks that Lazarus go to visit his brothers who are still alive, and tell them what to do to avoid his situation in hell. And Abraham points out again, no can do. And he shows that rich man that those who love the things of this life too much will not be persuaded to change their ways, even if someone were to rise from the dead. And this is a shot that Jesus is taking right at the Pharisees, because Jesus knows that he's going to die and rise again, and these guys are not going to change their minds about him. Well, in this tragic case, we are reminded of a couple of things here. And first of all, we are reminded that money is not everything. Like the Pharisees, there are those today who preach that if you are rich, God loves you more than poor people. And I even heard a sermon that said something like that in a Lutheran church, Missouri Synod congregation, this is a few years ago, in a town where the average income of the people in the city was twice what we have here in Edmond. I still can't believe I heard in a Lutheran church a pastor say, you know, your riches are because God loves you more. And I'm like, I just couldn't believe he said that. I mean, we are blessed to have what we have, and our blessings do come from God. But our chief pursuit in life is not supposed to be wealth. We're to be content with what God gives us, and we are to share what we have with those who don't have what we have. I think this parable is pretty clear on that. Another thing that we're reminded of here is that we need to know God's word and not ignore it like the rich guy did. We need to know Moses, the prophets, Jesus. We need to know all of it, and we need to know it well, and then we are to live the way it says to live in the Bible. Our faith is not something that we just pull out on a Sunday morning for a couple hours and then put it away for the rest of the week. Our faith and knowledge of the Word is something that should be going on, that we should be living by, that should be seen by others 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. We should love the Lord with all our hearts and all our souls and all our minds and all our strength. We should love our neighbors as ourselves. We should love our enemies and be kind to those who persecute us. Three very important passages in the Bible. And these are things that we should be doing because Jesus did them for us. We know that living this life in a truly God-pleasing way is impossible, but that's still no excuse because we sin. And that's why God had to send Jesus to die for us, to rise for us, and to gift us with his grace so that by faith we will not end up where that rich man ended up. Instead, by faith in the crucified and risen Jesus, we will also be with Abraham, with Jesus in heaven. Okay. So as we get close to the finish line here on this sermon, I want to finish by telling you this. Ken Kloss of the Lutheran Hour told the story years ago in a devotion that he wrote on the Lutheran Hour website. He told us about an Italian town called Sybaris, I think is how you pronounce that. And it was a town in Italy in 500 BC. In Sybaris, the people who lived there, they were wealthy. They had an advanced army. They had infantry. They had cavalry guys. They had guys that, you know, rode on horses with their swords and stuff, right? And this army of cavalry was so experienced and so excellent that everybody in the town thought, you know what, we've got it made, we're safe. Because those horses were so well trained that if music was played to these horses, instead of moving forward or whatever, they would prance in place, they would kind of dance, you know, kind of like the Lipizzaners, if you ever saw those. And so because they had money and they had this army and they had this really good cavalry, they're like, we've got it made. But here's the thing. The people outside of this town also heard about these horses that when they heard music, they started prancing and dancing. And so when Sybaris went to war against the army of Croton, which was a city 60 miles away, you know, here comes the army of Sybaris, you know, the men are marching, the guys in the horses, they're going like this, they got their swords drawn, they're ready to fight, and all of a sudden the people in Croton started playing some music, and the horses all go, they all stop, and they start dancing. And the guys are like, wait, go, you know. And they're dancing, and they got defeated, okay? Oops. So much for having it made. Well, the same is true for us. You may have it on occasion that You walk up to somebody, you know somebody, you work with somebody, you've got a neighbor, you look at them, man, they've got it made. And if you're talking to them, chances are they'll say, well, no, I've still got a problem with this, or something's going on here, or whatever, you know, because we're not content. That someone that you look at and you think, man, they've got everything, they'll tell you, well, I still want this and this and this and this, right? But here's the point I'm trying to make to you today. We've got it made. And God made sure of that by sending his son to save us. Do you think you're poor? Jesus was poor, and he had no home of his own. Remember, he said the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Do you feel alone? Jesus felt alone. His best friends left him. One of them betrayed him. Another denied even knowing him. Do you think life is unfair? Well, Jesus understands that because he never did anything wrong. All he did was love everybody, and they killed him for it. That's not fair. And he suffered those things for you. So those who are given faith in him might know that God's desire is to give us eternal life and eternal peace. Therefore, it is my prayer for all of us here this morning that we will not be distracted from the real riches of this life, but that God's word will continually remind us of what is truly important now and forever, because we've been given faith. We've been given forgiveness. We've been given eternal life for the sake of Jesus Christ, and there's nothing more valuable than that. We have those things. No matter how big our house is or isn't, no matter how cool our car is or isn't, no matter how fancy our phone is or isn't, iPhone 14 is out. I keep seeing that on the TV every time I turn it on. With God's gifts in here, blessed with the spiritual blessings Jesus won for us by his death and resurrection, it doesn't matter about anything else. We've got it made. In the name of Jesus, amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, may it keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Heavenly Father, please receive these gifts which we give back to you from that which you have first given to us. Amen. The congregation will please stand for the prayers and petitions of our congregation. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. God of mercy, you provide us with your holy word that we might know and believe in Jesus Christ. Make us diligent to study your word and dwell in your promises, that we are content with your provision in this life and joyfully look toward the life to come. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, preserve our homes from idols and sins of idleness. Bless fathers and mothers as they teach their children that generations to come might faithfully guard their hearts and rejoice in your gifts. Lord, in your mercy. King of kings and Lord of lords, watch over the authorities of this and every nation. Deliver them from the idols of wealth and power, and grant that they would use their offices in service to you and those who you have entrusted to their care. Protect our troops, including Tyler, Thomas, Chris, and Preston, Evan, Cannon, Teresa, and David, Maya, Grant, Chris, and David, John, Ben, Debbie, and Seth, Vanessa, Kendon, Christian, and Matthew, Jacob, Jonathan, and Nick. Lord, in your mercy, Almighty God, let your mercy come to all in need of your help. We lift up in prayer those who are printed in our bulletin insert here this morning, and we include and add to those prayers Merle Wagner and Tom and Kay March, and we also pray for Edmond Police Department Sergeant Joseph Wells, who was in an accident on Friday and is in the hospital this morning. We also pray in our hearts silently for a moment here this morning for all those that we know to be in need of God's grace and mercy. These things we pray that they might find their consolation in your promises until you deliver them from their troubles. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, grant that all who receive this holy supper today would be preserved from hard-heartedness, clothed in Christ's righteousness, and comforted by your gifts of life and salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation, for you've had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trusted him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. The table of the Lord is prepared for the people of the Lord. Come to the feast. Welcome to the Lord's table.
God's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. And is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
We stand for prayer. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. The congregation is invited to remain standing as we sing our closing song, Our God.
Water, you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. us you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God. Our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater. Stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
And all God's people said,
Amen.
I thank you very much for joining us this morning. That does conclude our public worship together here this morning. Obviously.